click the bell icon to get latest videos from Ekeeda.
Hello friends, I welcome you all to this video. We are with chapter 3 of microwave engineering, a family of microwave cross field tubes we are dealing with. The very popular cylindrical magnetron working as oscillator, also the linear magnetron, coaxial magnetron, the voltage tunable magnetron we are covered with. Now let us have a new device in this magnetron family, that is inverted coaxial magnetron. So here we begin with our topic, inverted coaxial magnetron. So as the title suggests us, inverted here. We are already covered with the coaxial magnetron in one of our previous video in the same chapter. So coaxial magnetron, we have seen that the axis of the cathode electrode and the anode electrode is the same. There are several slots for the purpose of resonance into the anode body. So everything is known to us as we have covered the operation of the coaxial magnetron. So what is getting inverted here? So as the two electrodes that are very important are cathode and anode, the positions of the cathode and anode are changed here. So earlier in the case of conventional magnetron or the coaxial magnetron, I must say that the cathode is inner electrode, whereas anode is outer electrode here. So cathode obviously provided with negative potential generating the free electrons. The free electrons are basically focused towards the anode as it is positively charged here, and for the magnetron operation to make oscillations produce here, we control the DC potential between these two electrodes and the magnetic flux density that is having perpendicular direction to the electric field. So we want the oscillations with the help of electron path here. So now as the positions of the cathode and the anode are inverted, are changed, so cathode will be becoming from inner to the outer electrode and the anode will be becoming outer to the inner electrode. So let us see how the diagram for the inverted coaxial magnetron will be. So here we have this particular diagram. So in this diagram, the very important electrode, that is cathode, negatively charged. So let us number this to be 1. So it is of very much significance. Without this electrode, we cannot start operation of this device. So this is inverted coaxial magnetron. As you see this particular arrow, it is pointing to the outer cylinder. So usually we found anode to be having the outer cylinder and inside there it was a cathode. Here the situation is changed here. So cathode is outer cylinder here. Now the another electrode positively charged that we can show here, that is naming anode vein here. So let us say this is the second electrode for importance, and the various n number of veins made for the purpose of resonance, and there it will be of course a coupling of energies associated with these resonant cavities with the help of various slots, as we have seen into the simple coaxial conventional magnetron will be definitely there here. So anode is a part of this inner cylinder and cathode is outer here. Now here we have the cylindrical cavity resonator, a part of anode structure, and it has the propagation in the space in between with the mode TE011. So this is the same mode that we have seen in the case of coaxial magnetron. So for cavity resonator we have the three dimensions, the two dimensions for the cross section and one dimension for the length. So generally what we have TE MNP, so it has the values 011. So this is the particular mode of propagation of the signal inside the cavity resonator space here. Now the induced RF current, will be having this particular circulating or rotating direction in the case of inverted coaxial magnetron. Now the cathode and anode, the two electrodes we have already shown, the development of electric field is also shown into this diagram. There it is the existence of the perpendicular orientation of the magnetic flux density here, magnetic field here. So we consider here the positive z direction for the magnetic flux density, hence the BZ component. The direction is marked with the cross inside a circle here. So as the dimensions of the two electrodes to be talked about, here we have the radius of the cathode, that is the outer electrode, we have designated with the symbol small b here. Usually for the case of cathode, we used to have the radius with the denotation of small a, the smaller radius, but here the smaller radius is for the anode. So anode will be having the radius denoted by small a, and the cathode will be denoted with the radius small b here. Now at the center, as we have the orientation of the magnetic flux density component marked here, the z component, from the center, that will be actually at the axis of the two cylinders, the cathode and the anode here, we make a radial direction. The radial direction outward from this axis can be denoted, and if we take for the convenience cylindrical coordinate system into the use, that direction will be of rho component here. Now there is a small slit in between the veins of the anode for the purpose of coupling the resonance between the cavities here. So this is the inverted coaxial magnetron. Now we shall be having a simple derivation, making the use of the electron motion equations, so that we can determine the formulations for the Hull's cutoff potential for the magnetron, also the Hull's cutoff magnetic flux density. Now to see the orientations of the electric and magnetic field both in this particular device, and the electron generated at the outer electrode cathode. The electron motion will be governed by the equations here we give in the cylindrical coordinate system. The first equation there, it will be d2 rho divided by dt square minus rho in multiplication of, here we have d phi by dt bracket squared is equal to, the RHS will be by E by M in multiplication to E rho component minus E by M in multiplication to rho into BZ component into d phi by dt here. So let us say this is equation number one. So in this equation, when we have only d rho by dt, it is the velocity of the electron into the radial direction rho. When we have d phi by dt, it is the velocity of the electron into the angular direction or the circular or the rotational direction. D2 rho by dt square gives us the acceleration of the electron in the radial direction. So now this was equation number one. The second equation governing the motion of electron will be 1 upon rho in multiplication to the time differential of the bracket, that has rho square into d phi by dt. It will be equal to E by M into BZ component in multiplication to d phi by dt. So let this is equation number two. So in the very first chapter, introduction to microwaves, we have already covered the electron motion in the presence of individual electric field, magnetic field and the electromagnetic field. So these are the electron motion equations in the presence of electromagnetic field having the cross orientation. Now in these two equations, we have the ratio E by M onto the right hand side. So E is the electric charge, M is the electric mass, electron mass. So it has the constant values, hence the ratio is also a constant. The value is 1.759 into 10 raised to the power 11 C per kg into the MKS or the SI system of units. Now in these equations, we have used the magnetic flux density denoted by BZ component. So positive Z direction for the magnetic flux density we have been opting here. Now let us make some rearrangement to equation number 2 so that we obtain ddt of rho square in bracket d phi by dt is equal to E by M BZ component into rho into d rho by dt, the velocity, which can be also expressed in terms of 1 by 2 omega c in multiplication to ddt of rho square. Let the next equation number will be equation number 3 here. So in this equation, on to the right hand side, we have introduced omega c. So omega c is given in place of E by M into BZ component. This is called as cyclotron angular frequency. So cyclotron angular frequency depends on to the magnetic flux density that is having perpendicular orientation to the electron motion here, and E by M are the constants here. Now we can make integration to the previous equation, and the new equation will be obtained as rho square d phi by dt will be equal to 1 by 2 omega c, that is the cyclotron angular frequency, in multiplication to rho square plus a constant that we obtain after integration. So let this will be the equation number 4 here. So with respect to the above equation, we can take a condition that we select the radial direction length rho to be equal to small b. So small b in the diagram we have shown to be the radius of the cathode electrode. So at this particular cathode electrode, the electron will be just formed there, and it will be at the static condition, not into any kind of motion. Therefore we can select the angular velocity, that is d phi by dt, to be equal to 0. So this implies to the equation number 4 that whatever the constant we have obtained by taking the integration to equation number 3, so this equals minus 1 by 2 omega c into b square, b in the place of rho. Therefore we can rewrite the above equation, and it will be d phi by dt equal to 1 by 2 omega c, in the bracket we have 1 minus b square divided by rho square. Let this will be equation number 5. Individual magnetic field will not be affecting the motion of the electron. Therefore, the kinetic energy associated with the electron can be expressed in the next equation, where we write the kinetic energy 1 by 2 m v square, it will be given by E into capital V. So let this is equation number 6 here. Now from this equation, we can have the components of the velocity in terms of rho and phi direction. Therefore we get v square onto the left hand side equated to twice into E by M into capital V. So here we can make it in the representations of v rho square plus v phi square. Therefore we write them to equal d rho by dt bracket square plus, in the bracket here we have rho into d phi by dt bracket square. Let us say this is equation number 7 for left hand side for v square here. Now we can put the condition for the length, that is radial distance rho will be equal to A. So A is the radius of the anode electrode, that is having the shorter radius value. So at this particular condition, we are having the V potential to be of anode potential given by V0. Also we have the radial velocity, that is d rho by dt will be equal to 0. So substituting these two conditions at the above equation, we obtain the equation number 6 and equation number 7 to be at d phi by dt equal to 1 by 2 omega c in the bracket 1 minus b square by a square. This is the new equation, I name it equation number 8. And also we have a square in the bracket d phi by dt bracket squared equal to twice E by M into capital V0. So this will be the next equation number 9 here. Substituting from the equation number 8 to equation number 9, we obtain a square in the bracket 1 by 2 omega c in the bracket 1 minus b square by a square. The square bracket is also squared here, and this is equal to twice E by M into capital V0. So the next equation number, it will be 10 here. Finally, from these equations, we can find the cutoff potential equation that we call Hull's cutoff voltage equation, given as here we can express V suffix 0C is equal to E by 8M into B0 square small a square in the bracket 1 minus B square by a square. So I outline this important equation. This equation is equation number 11, the Hull's cutoff voltage equation for the case of inverted coaxial magnetron. The information from this equation can be as such: if we keep the anode voltage V0 less than the cutoff anode potential denoted in the above equation V0C, so in that case, if we keep the magnetic flux density to be constant so that the electron will not reach the anode, it will just graze the anode and come back to the cathode position, which is outer cylinder in this magnetron. Similarly, if we can have this voltage to be constant, we can also obtain the Hull's cutoff magnetic flux density equation. So it will be given by capital B suffix 0 C equated to the RHS will be having the numerator minus in the bracket 8 times capital V0 into M by E to the power we have 1 by 2 in the denominator, A in the bracket 1 minus B square by A square. So let us say this is equation number 12, the last equation we outline. Now here the condition can be taken: when the magnetic flux density capital B is maintained greater than this Hull's cutoff magnetic flux density B suffix 0C, and provided the anode potential to be a constant here, a fixed value here, the electron will not reach to the anode. So after the derivation of the Hull's cutoff potential and the Hull's cutoff magnetic flux density for the inverted coaxial magnetron, we shall be having a simple comparison with the conventional coaxial magnetron here. So here we have one diagram. So in this diagram, we have the conventional rising sun magnetron. The anode is shown, that is a part of outer cylinder, and this is the cathode, which is inner cylinder, negatively charged here. Whereas in the inverted coaxial magnetron, the positions have been just swapped here. Now, what is the advantage of swapping the positions to make the cathode the outer cylinder? Whatever the cathode current density it is there here, as we want the electron to go inside the cylindrical cavities or the device here, we can make a reduction into the current density of the cathode up to 1/10. So this will practically make higher life possible to the device here. So this is the advantage. By the next lecture, we shall be having a practice of a simple problem based on the inverted coaxial magnetron. I hope you are getting the details of microwave engineering devices very well. So for more information like this, you can subscribe to Ekeeda channel. Thank you.